Good evening. Thank you for attending this webinar in this fantastic evening outside. My name is Ferry. I will be the moderator for our session today. Before we start, there are a couple of housekeeping rules that I would like to share with you. So first of all, please make sure that your name that appears on the Microsoft Teams is the same first and last name that you registered for this event. And this is required for the CPE certificate later on. And second one is, as you can see, the presentation is recorded. And then later on, alongside the video, the presentation will also be shared with you. And across this webinar session, please mute your microphone and turn off your video. If you have any questions, please put those questions on the chat box. We will have the question and answer at the end of the presentation. Okay. So today we will have Dave Funstein. He's a agile security consultant at CBA. He will talk through the security in the DevOps environment. Okay. And for next week, please, if you haven't registered, please register for our session. We have an ERP integration and ISO standard next week, and we have at the same time as today. So without further ado, I think I will give the session back to Dave. Dave?
Yeah, thank you, Ferry. And thank you, Isaka, for giving me the opportunity to talk tonight. I will start share my screen. This should do it. So yeah, tonight I'm going to give you a little talk with the interesting phrase, why killing your current InfoSec program is a good idea. And I will give you a practical guide how to do that in 5 easy steps. And of course, that's a bit of clickbait, but it's more or less what I do in reality. So I work for CBA. I work as an agile security consultant. And basically what that means is that I try to reconnect the fast world of software development and the quite often slower world of enterprise information security. I do that for a company called CBA. And something about myself, I have 3 cats. I love to snorkel on Lanzarote, so I can't wait until we can travel again. And if you want to reach out to me afterwards, feel free to do so. I'm very easily findable. My email is here. You can find me on Twitter. You can find me on LinkedIn. And on my LinkedIn profile, I also have a calendly invite if you want to have a team session afterwards of 30 minutes. So make use of that. So tonight's story is about information security and software development, or as we like to call it nowadays, AppSec. But before we can do that, let's travel a bit back in time to see how we ended up in the world where we are now. So it all started somewhere in the 60s, 70s, when computers became more powerful, more affordable for big companies, that is. And we really started to make use of all the capabilities that they offered. And back then, you basically had individuals that did everything. And we nowadays would like to call those people sysadmins, but they were developer, they were operator, they maintained the stuff, they even did the hardware and the software. So they were responsible for everything. And that went on for quite some time, until roughly 1983, when the internet became available and more popular and opened up a whole new world of possibilities. And that's when you saw a real change in how we looked at software. Suddenly software was no longer limited to a single system where one person was working with, or in the case of mainframes, maybe a bunch of users from a local network. Now suddenly we had systems opening up to the whole world. And slowly you saw that software development was something that became more and more individual as a capability. And that all accelerated somewhere around 1989 when a researcher at CERN in Switzerland decided that it was a good idea to create something called the World Wide Web, where you could easily share information with other people. That person made it even more easy to connect to all sorts of systems. And that held on for a couple of years until in 1995, Barclays was really hacked and decided, okay, we have to start looking different at security. Software development obviously is not doing a good job. And they decided to introduce the first role, the first CISO in the world, Steve Katz. And he got the assignment, you have carte blanche, whatever you need, whatever needs to happen, do it. We do not want this to happen again. So he created basically the foundations of what we nowadays call information security. Meanwhile, on the other hand, software development was also not was also looking at how can we do things differently, and Microsoft had a couple of rough years with the early Windows versions up to the point where they had a system that was no longer sustainable, and they said, okay, we need to completely look differently at how we develop software. And in 2000, they basically open sourced the software development lifecycle as they saw it. And it was quality focused, it had security in mind, everything that you needed was in there. And it's, by the way, still a great source if you want to know how to develop software properly. And then in 2004, software developers also realized, hey, but the way we are doing things is also not really optimal. We had slow projects that took months, where estimates were completely off. And they said, okay, how can we do them differently? And in 2004, a couple of developers created what they called the Agile Manifesto. And it contained promises that the whole world would be better. Everything would be fast. It would be fully visible, transparency. Everything was on time. It was exactly what we needed. That was clearly the solution. And here we are nowadays. So if you look at how well are we developing software nowadays, especially if you look at the security part of software development, you actually see that most industries are maybe in the maturing phase. Some of them are a bit more mature than others, especially the more new industries often have better control than the older industries, but basically we're not doing very well. And also if you look at the so-called security frameworks that we have, and you take a look at what are they actually finding, what are they, how much does it cover, you actually see that we're also not doing a very good job there either. Yeah? It doesn't really matter which framework you take, roughly 25% of the problems you can imagine is simply not found or covered or identified by any of these frameworks. And if you look at software itself, this is a research from, 2003 or something like that. But it's still valid nowadays. About 2/3 of the software that we develop in general is not even used by the end user. We make software, we deploy it, we introduce vulnerabilities, we introduce bugs, we have to maintain that, and 2/3 of that is not even used. And quite often we do not even have the time to fix all the stuff. And that's even worse, because there's also research that the longer you ignore problems in your software, the harder it becomes to fix. And if you extrapolate that, you arrive at the point where maintaining your software consumes all your time. Meaning that you can no longer respond to the wishes and the needs of your users. Basically meaning you can no longer operate the business. At least you cannot innovate anymore. And we can more or less predict where this will end. Eh? So if we do not fix this, it will not work out for the best. So let's see how this all happened. And basically, if it has to do with how you reflect or how you behave towards change. And there are basically two strategies. And you also see that in nature. You can either choose the way of being robust, so being able to resist change, be able to stop change from impacting you. And that is more or less the route that information security took. Yeah? We focus heavily on hardening, on patching, on vulnerability management, on preventing or to keep something as much as possible to a certain baseline. The other way you can cope with change is by adopt to change, by continuously change, by continuously try to be better suited for your new environment. That's called agile, eh? And not agile the software development methodology, but agile as a behavioral aspect. And that is more like survival of the fittest. And you can see that these two approaches are hard to combine. And you cannot, it's difficult to both resist change and go along with it. And you can also, the problem is how these two worlds look at each other, because both think that they're doing the exact right thing. If you look at software development, with their adaptability, with their continuously be able to change, they think they create these shiny sports cars which have all the bells and whistles that you want, and it's exactly what you need. Information security, on the other hand, is looking at the world as we protect everything. We make sure that these cars can actually drive. We make sure that no accidents happen. In reality, both of these approaches don't really work. Yes, you can be robust, but the problem is that if you become too robust, you become so inert that you become fragile again. Yeah, so there is a sort of robustness overkill. And that's exactly what you see happening in many companies. Yes, policies, protocols, configurations are good to have. But there is a point where it becomes counterproductive. And that actually harms your organization. On the other hand, the same is true for Agile. We often think that we are very adaptable, very transparent, deliver everything exactly on time. But there's a lot of bias in what we do. And in reality, quite often you see that we still do not deliver the right things. And especially if you look at the security components, there's a huge blind spot in software development where we end up with a situation that actually we do not like. And the reality is that if you ask both of these parties how they look at the other, you get a completely different picture. Information security often looks at software development as a bunch of cowboys that deliver broken stuff that is certainly not secure. On the other hand, software development looks at information security as the department with a lot of useless policies, pointless procedures, and a lot of things that simply don't add value. So this is actually the problem that we need to fix. Because if you don't, this is what you will end up with. In the end, information security will be the one cleaning up the shit from software development. And I don't know about you, but I don't like being in this role. So this is what I do in reality. This is what I try to fix. And we need to fix that. So how can, and nobody discusses the need for security. Yeah? That's point one. Everybody reads the news, everybody reads the internet. We all understand security is important, not just for the bad guys, but also for all sorts of regulators, because there's a bunch of people on the internet just looking around what they can do. So this is not a topic of discussion. What we do need to think about is how secure do we want to be? And this is a nice image from an artist in London. And he took a look at car accidents, and he wanted to design the most secure human he could imagine. So he created this statue, and this is a human, how a human would look like if he would be able to survive any car crash. So this is the most secure human that you can imagine. And that's all nice, but this is certainly not the way many people would like to look like. Yeah? So 100% secure is probably not the goal you need to go for. It needs to be safe enough. Eh? I mean, we all drive cars, and that goes relatively well without looking like this. So we need to find a new balance. Eh? So we need to make things more simple, and we need to get a new baseline. Where do we need to be? And basically, it kind of boils down that we need to completely hold over the way we look at security. Yeah? So nowadays we have a lot of mitigations, controls, toll gates, things that slow stuff down just to make sure that no accidents happen. And we need to overhaul that to a system where we are more in the realm of advising, about giving guidance, about allowing people to make their own decisions as long as we inform them about the risks. And at the same time, of course, we need to make sure that things don't go completely bonkers. Huh? We do not want accidents. We do not want things to completely break down. But that should be the goal. So I promise you 5 simple steps. We're going to start with step number 1. And step number 1 is quite simple. Stop being a department. Quite often, especially in the enterprises where I work with, you see that information security is a separate department with their own personnel, not really aligned with the business, or not having close interactions with the business. And that is working quite independently, and that is a problem in itself. So, and why is that a problem? Well, there is something called stakeholder management, and everybody does that in reality, but especially if you look in agile organizations, this is actually something that is taught to product owners. And what it boils down to is that there are 4 kinds of people. There's people with influence who have the capability to slow you down, to harm you, to question you. And there's people that have an interest in what you do. And if you combine them, you get this quadrant. And especially if we look at the upper quadrant, where security quite often is, because we have the influence to slow things down, to challenge people, to escalate stuff. You have the option to either be interested in what they do or don't. And if you are not interested, software development will do exactly the minimal amount of effort to keep you off their back. And that's not the situation where you want to be in. That's not what you want. You want the software development to do what is necessary, not the minimal amount of stuff to make sure that you don't notice them anymore. And to do that, you have to actively engage. You have to be involved in the teams, in the business. You have to understand what they're doing and be a part of that. To do that, you really have to understand that in an agile environment, everything is combined. So there is no start, there's no end, there's no separate phases. Everything is a continuum, and responsibility is shared by everybody. So from a security point of view, you have to align with that. You have to give teams the responsibility, but you also have to combine your activities with other activities a team already does that are more or less similar. And it also means that you have to be really clear about your strategy. Yeah? So instead of acting on feelings, we all know the terminology FUD, fear, uncertainty, doubt. we need to start working on its effects. We need to start working or thinking about how can security help? How can you make sure that you deliver your software? We also have to make sure that we tell teams, if you implement this, you are allowed to do that. And not say, okay, you're not allowed to do that because it's too dangerous. So we have to be really proactive, and we have to make sure that, or we have to allow everybody to take their own responsibility in there. And the most important part is, your end goal should be that people are no longer depending on specific security experts in your organization. And so the end goal is to make your job obsolete. And of course, that will never happen. But your whole strategy should be according to that philosophy. Make yourself obsolete. And one of the effective ways to do that is simply looking at how the army nowadays approaches problems. So 200 years ago, we had a really detailed command organization in the military. So there was one person at the top. He created a strategy. He draw all the routes. He decided who should be where at what time, which weapons were there, how we are going to approach the enemy, etc., etc. So it was a whole playbook that was invented on beforehand. And it worked well until minute two in the war, and then things were differently than anticipated, and everything just blew up, and it was more or less a matter of, well, let's hope that you survive. Nowadays, we have more a mission command. And so we have teams, and teams are trained in certain capabilities. They are trained in certain events, in how to approach certain situations. They are given a mission statement, like get that person out of that building. And after that, it's up to them. They can decide how to do that. They can choose a strategy. They can choose the routes. They can deviate from those plans when they need to. And if everything goes wrong, they have the options to call in for air support or stuff like that. But the teams are trained to do these missions. They get the responsibility to finish them, and they're just offered certain strategies and support systems to make them to make it possible for them to actually do the mission. And that's also how we need to do to act as security departments towards software development. We do not need to tell them how to do stuff or what to do, what not to do. We have to tell them what the strategy is, what we want to prevent, and how they prevent that. That should be a team decision. I mean, we have capable engineers, we have capable software developers. They understand the code probably better than we do. So let them make the right decisions. We just have to tell them, make sure that this cannot happen. And you really have to give teams the motivation to work with that. And that's the part where we say, okay, make security not only everybody's responsibility, but also make it something fun. Make it something people like to work with, to talk about. And there's a lot of things you can do. I mean, we have these cool training applications where you can learn how to hack. There are hacking frameworks. You can run internal bug bounty programs. And most developers really like to experiment with that, with want to verify how does this work, and what can my application actually do. And lastly, you have to make sure that you find a way to make that information, make that experience flow through your organization. So it's about how can you make sure that this knowledge does not stay in individuals' heads, but how can you make sure that it actually is being shared amongst the whole organization. And there's various ways to do that. But in essence, it's all about create a sort of community. Make sure that this becomes a topic that interested people talk about. And also make sure that it's something all teams talk about. So that was first step. So we now got out of our ivory tower. We're in the organization, and we made security a topic that people think is fun and want to talk about. The next step is make these teams experience with the concept of risk. Make sure that they don't consider it that to be something special, but something that they just have to think about. And that all starts with making teams aware that not only are normal users, intended users, using the systems, but also a whole bunch of other people. I mean, it's connected to the internet. You have no control who visits your systems, but you can be pretty sure that many of them do not have the good intentions. They do not want to use your application as you intend it to be used. And a very effective way to do that is learn teams how to do threat modeling. And threat modeling is basically about what could possibly go wrong. And you do not need to be a real security expert to think about those things. You can start very lightweight just by defining what you want to prevent. So we call them security stories or abuser stories or evil user stories. But ask teams for every story that you have, for every requirements that you can think of, see if you can define the stuff that you want to prevent, and really write that down. The next step is learn from your mistakes. So in information security, we have something that we call the root cause analysis. That's actually not that common in software development. So train them in really investigating if something went wrong, find out what the cause was and fix that cause. And make that also a very transparent process. For example, if you take the aviation industry, they are very good at that. So if something went wrong, it's completely blameless. They're not interested in whose fault was that to file complaints. They just want to learn what happened, how can we prevent that in the future, and make sure that people continuously learn from the process. And that's basically what we call the Kaizen mindset. So if there's a problem, not only fix the leak, but really go towards the root cause of why is it leaking, and how can you make sure that whatever happens, this doesn't happen again, because otherwise you end up with a whole bunch of temporary solutions without fixing the actual problem. And lastly, don't wait for bad things to happen. On purpose, break your system, or at least think about how that could happen. So there's these things called red team, blue team exercises, where you have two teams competing with each other. You can also use rules of misfortune, which are basically tabletop exercises or thought experiments or role-playing games, whatever you want to call them. But it's hypothetical situations. This happened, what would you do? And by just running these scenarios, you can already figure out, hey, if this happens, we probably needed this information, and now that we think of it, we don't have it. So you can already learn a lot from these hypothetical exercises. And ultimately, you might even want to use tools to actually try to kill your systems. For example, Netflix created the Simian Army. It's a collection of tools. They run them on their systems, and basically they're sort of internal viruses. They purposely try to break in their own systems, kill processes, terminate network connections, just to check, are our systems able to handle that and fix that on their own. I don't recommend starting with that phase, but it's interesting to see, can we grow towards a situation where you can actually are able to handle that. So we now have made security an interesting topic. We are training teams how to think about risks, how to think about security. The next step is to decentralize security automation. And security automation is quite often already a topic in many organizations. Think like a static analysis or vulnerability scanners or stuff like that. But the problem is often that because they're centralized, they also become a blocking factor again. Yeah? And you want teams to be able to do their own scans, their own tests, and make their own decisions. And developers love that. They are all about automation. And the whole DevOps movement, the whole cloud movement is about automation, essentially. It's about making their lives more easy. And from a security point of view, that is very good, because automation saves you a lot of time. And if you save time, things become cheaper. And if things become cheaper, then the quality increases. And so by automating security tasks and making them as fast as possible, you end up with a higher security level or a higher quality level. And what should you think about? Well, start with the stuff that now causes a lot of consumes a lot of time. Yeah? So all your PDFs, Word files, Excel files, all these manual tasks that take hours to complete and days to process, start with those. Quite often, the stuff that's being asked in those things is really binary. Are you doing this or that? Things that you can answer with yes or no. That's typically the stuff that you can use automation to determine for you. And especially in modern software development, most of the deployment pipeline is automated anyway. So the tools know exactly what happened. So there's no lying there. You can just ask the tool, is this in place? Did you do that? Is that check finished? Did you really run all the necessary tests? And there are no humans needed anymore to fill those things in. Yeah, so that's typically the stuff where you start with, embed and automate, or at least make it more accessible. But you have to be careful, because there is so much you can nowadays automate. You should not automate everything, because automation in itself will make things more complex. And if things become more complex, then it will break more often. And if it breaks, people will try to bypass that. And so you do not want to make things over complex. And also you want to make sure that you do not introduce so many stuff, so many scanning tools, so many checks, that it becomes a burden again on your software development. Huh? So you have to find a balance between what do we actually want to see, what do we need to see, and what are we skipping for the sake of time. And this means that you really have to be aware about what are we actually checking for and why are we checking that. The disadvantage is, especially if you talk about delivering pipelines, it's nice that you have all these security features in there, but you have to also start thinking about the security of the pipeline itself, because quite often these tools are also not secure for by default, not secure from the start. So this becomes your new weak spot if you're not careful. You also have to think about your secrets and your access control. These things basically become the new backbone of your whole organization. There's lots of interesting stuff in there. If somebody gets access to that system, he can really wreak havoc. So be aware of the fact that this becomes a new critical system. So start logging what happens inside the system. So not only your applications, but also keep track of what is in that system. And not only start logging it, monitor the stuff. Really put a dashboard that really shows what goes through the pipeline, who had access to that, where information was coming from, where it went to. Because you do not want to end up in a situation where all your systems are infected just because you missed something. But if you do this properly, there's a lot of benefits. First of all, you end up in a situation where everything is code. So everything is described, everything is text files. There's no room anymore for human interpretation, steps being skipped, stuff like that. So everything is in scripts, and that means that you only have to validate that script. And as long as that script is not changed, and that's being used to, I don't know, copy hundreds of systems, you exactly know that all of these hundreds of systems are the same, and therefore either vulnerable or not. There's no room for interpretation anymore. And also, systems become interchangeable. And this is what quite often in DevOps world is called the pets versus cattle situation. I don't like that. I like animals, so I converted it to old-timers versus rental cars. But the essence is the same. Old-timers are something we cherish. They're unique. When they break, we either try to fix them, and if we can't fix them completely, well, we accept the fact that they are not ideal, but still okay. That's how we quite often treat servers. Servers are given unique names. We try to patch them. If a patch fails, then, well, we simply allow that to happen because, hey, it's still running. So, yeah, the no fix, okay, that's fine. And you want to end up in a situation where you say, if a system doesn't exactly meet your requirements, you just simply destroy it and rebuild it. And if it starts behaving weird, you destroy it and you rebuild it. If it needs to be patched, you just destroy it and redeploy it with all the new versions and run all your tests automatically, etc., etc. So this really gives you an opportunity to start looking at your systems way more neutral. And there's no room for deviations anymore. And if everything is code and everything is automated, you can also start automating your audit trails. There's no need for people looking through code, looking through configuration files, looking for change requests. You can continuously check that and put it on the dashboard. And also put a sort of circle diagrams to show you we are currently 88% compliant without any human intervention. and that way you end up with a system where you have continuous security. Yeah? So you do the right things at the right time at the right level. So we have all that in place. So how can we make sure that we actually become the catalyst in the organization? We do not want to be the blocking factor anymore. We want to actually help the organization. And that's by making sure that security is the fast route. So the fastest way to do that is doing it securely. And if we then go back to the Agile Manifesto, it's all about how doing things that add value. So we have to make sure that security is a factor that actually adds value. And if you do not do the secure route, you have less value. So we need to start mapping our security systems to whatever happens in the organization and to do exactly that is necessary at that point in time. And again, Microsoft really has a very cool approach towards this. They basically say you have three types of processes: stuff that you only do once or once a year, stuff that you do frequently but not necessarily for every change, and stuff that you basically want to know always before you go to production. And that mindset, that is something that we also need to implement more for security systems. And it all starts with some simple ground rules. We talked about teams taking responsibility. We talked about automating the whole process. But still, there are things that you say, okay, this is not allowed anywhere in time. No matter what you do, this is something that we simply do not do. And these should be your ground rules. And they should be a simple list, easy to understand, and really fit to the real critical business risks. So make this as small as possible, but clear for everybody. Then start introducing ways for teams to do their own risk assessments, and make that, again, easily accessible, simple, yes, no questions, not too many. It's not about getting all the details. It's just to give teams an impression, hey, you are in the danger zone, or okay, whatever you're doing, this looks fine. We don't care. But give teams the capability to be able to do this quickly themselves. Preferably on a user story level, but at very least on sprint level. Give them also clear thresholds. What is allowed and what is not allowed? And really make sure that if they're in the green zone, they can just move forward, and there's no chance that somebody else in your organization will say, hey, you didn't do that check. We're going to stop the project and do it anyway. So your governance structure should be aligned with this. But if a team is in the green zone, they should be allowed to go forward. And only when they're in the red zone, there's some intervention, and you slow down and you start looking at, okay, what is going on here? What needs to be done? And continuously monitor where are teams, how are they performing? So choose a maturity model. There are several available. I will show you one later or in a couple of slides. But keep track about the progress that teams are doing. Keep track of their maturity. And give them more room to operate on their own ideas if they show an increase in maturity. And also gamify that. I'm now currently working with a customer that really has an internal maturity model with physical badges. And every team that moves to the next level gets a physical badge. And back when we were still working in the office, every team had this bar with all the shields that they earned. So there was really a competitive edge in there. Again, that's to make it fun, to make it something people talk about, but keep track about how teams are performing. But keep in mind that the ultimate goal is to create a safe highway, not a highway that continuously limits your speed, has toll gates, slows you down, because in the end, you want to move as fast as safely possible towards your destination, not as slow as possible. And the last step is start using security as a marketing tool. And this is probably the hardest part of being in information security. Because the thing is, if you look at the stuff that we stand for, and you start looking at how development looks at wishes and desires from all their stakeholders, we're not really in the attractive part of this scheme. So there are basically three types of changes in an application. In the middle, you have the satisfiers, and that's just the basic stuff that you need to continuously maintain to keep your customers happy. On the upper hand, you have the delighters, and the delighters is the stuff that nobody misses until it's there. So think about iPhone, think about Tesla. That is the stuff that everybody is aiming for. You didn't miss it when it wasn't there. Now it's here, and you can't imagine a world without it. And then there's this stuff called basic expectations, and that's the stuff nobody cares about until it's not there. And then you become really annoyed. And this is where security and privacy and compliance is. If it's there, nobody really cares. However, if it's absent and stuff breaks because of that absence, then people start getting annoyed. So the challenge for security is, how can you get from that red line towards the blue line? Because if you have to, if you need to have a discussion with a product owner or a product manager, they will listen more to you if you're on the blue line, because that is the stuff that their consumers, their end users want to have, need to have, and not the stuff that can be ignored until a certain level. So the big challenge is, how can you get from the red line to the blue line? And one of the things you can do is just go out in the open. Show your customers that you take this stuff seriously, but also show your customers exactly what can be expected. And there are various ways to do that. I have three examples here. GitLab, for example, open sourced all of their internal policies. Everything that is described internally is available on the website, even all their security processes, everything that how the risk management works, what they think is acceptable, everything is open source. On the other hand, you have examples like Amazon, and Amazon really states, created the shared responsibility model, which clearly states the responsibilities for Amazon, but also for the customers. Yeah? So they clearly show, this is what you can expect from us. This is stuff that you need to take care of, and we help you in this way. And so there's no room for error, no room for interpretation. And you have companies like Capital One that are really out in the open with how they do stuff. They have their very active blogs. They are on many conferences. They explain and showcase a lot of stuff that they're doing within their own software development. And they're a bank. And so that's quite uncommon, I think. So... In summary, we now had the five steps on how to kill your information security policy, or actually make it more effective, more valuable. And to summarize, we have to change our ways. This is called the Security Agile Manifesto. You can find it on secdevops.org, I believe. But if you just Google for Security Agile Manifesto, you will find it. And this states, basically similar to the Agile Manifesto, how we should change our vision towards security. Yeah? So it's about stop saying no and go along with teams. And that doesn't mean continuously say yes, but think about what they're trying to achieve, why that adds value, and how can you make sure that that becomes possible. Yeah, so print this out, put it above your bed, and start memorizing this. It's also about cooperating with the whole system. Yeah? So not just being aligned with the business, be aligned with software development teams, be aligned with operations, understand that you as a whole have the responsibility to make sure that your company keeps adding value, and really think about how can you help others to achieve that value. And lastly, don't reinvent the wheel. There's already a lot out there that helps you to set this up. This is, for example, SAM, the Software Assurance Maturity Model from OWASP. Basically, it's a framework how you can integrate a successful application security or secure software development strategy. But Microsoft is also a good source. There's plenty of them. And if you want to talk about that, contact me. I can help you find the right model for you, but don't think about all this stuff yourself. There's a lot of people that already thought about this. You just have to think how you can actually make that work within your company. And then finally, we end up in utopia, where we're no longer cleaning up the shit of all the unicorns, but actually tell the unicorns how to do their job. We feed the unicorns, and we make sure that the unicorns can actually run around. So that was the end of my talk. Well, still mostly within the time. So yeah. I don't know if there are any questions.
Thank you very much.
People want to discuss.
Thank you very much, Dave. So at the moment, there is no questions on the chat. But if any of you have any questions, just use the raise your hand button so that we can moderate. While waiting for the questions, I do have my own question, if you don't mind. Okay. So this is kind of, for me, more like how the internal security team, I don't want to call it department anymore now, the internal security team can work together with, let's say, the another internal team. Mm-hmm. But what is your view about the external who is looking inside, like the external auditors, regulators, because there is also the gap in terms of mindset of security in the modern agile software development.
So I agree with you. So if you look at auditors having to audit organizations that are working agile and DevOps, that is a topic in itself to give another webinar about, I think. But the key thing is that if you want to assess if something is working properly, if it really mitigates risk, you have to understand how that system works. And so for auditors, I think it's important to really deep dive in how does agile development work, how does DevOps work, what is the different mindset and the philosophy behind that, and there's more to agile than just putting stuff in production every other week. There's a bigger world behind that. And responsibility and governance is structured completely differently. So you really have to understand the basic concepts behind that before you can actually assess if something is working. If you don't do that, you get into weird situations, and I actually encountered them where auditors wanted to have a list of all the users in a Docker container, while that Docker container was created by a tool, and all access to that system was just blocked. There was no way to look into that. And still the auditor said, I want to have a list of all the users, which was just impossible because there are no users in that system. And that was because that auditor didn't understand what he was assessing. He didn't understand the concepts. He just thought or ported the classical visions on the modern technology, and that mismatched. And if you assess something and there's a mismatch and you don't understand that, then you get conclusions that are pointless. And so that is my message towards external auditors: really understand what you are looking at.
All right, clear. Actually, one of our participants, Peter Ansbergen, said that actually auditing agile DevOps is not a problem. It's even normally better than performing the conventional methods.
Well, I'm glad to see Peter write that, because that to me gives the impression that Peter is somebody who understands what the philosophy behind it is, and sees that because of this approach, there's actually less room for deviations and stuff to break. So I agree with you, Peter. If you understand agile, if you understand DevOps, then this should be the conclusion. It's quite often better. But like I had the example I just gave, if you do not understand what you're looking at, then things become way more complex for an auditor. And you run into a lot more discussions.
All right, clear. Anyone else would like to raise his or her question? You can just raise your hand.
Or anybody who solemnly disagrees. That's also fine.
You can also do that. I said very calm today, so I guess everybody agree, nodding, yeah, I got your point. Maybe then my last question before we wrap up this evening. So in your experience, right, consulting many different, let's ask Peter Knappen directly with this question. Peter, can you ask directly your question to Dave?
Yes, I can. You told nice ways of working to improve security and to get it more accepted and to have added value. But my question is how to integrate the security professionals in the DevOps teams.
Yeah, and then are you then talking about scaling problems or something like that? Is that your focus, or how to make security people work together with developers, for example?
The last one, yes.
So your question basically is how can you make security people more aligned with development teams to make sure that they can actually cooperate? Yeah.
Yes, because again, in the reality, you see that many security professionals handle like a policeman.
Yeah. Exactly. So the whole chat I gave about make security a topic that lives in your organization, it works both ways. Eh? You also have to make sure that security people understand that they are indeed not a policeman, but they are also responsible for adding value to the end product. Mm-hmm. And that means that they are already part of development. We just chose in 1996 to push them in their own department. And as a result of that, many of the ties between security and business are being cut at the moment. So we have to align them better. We have to integrate security again better in the organization. That's also why I said stop being a department, stop acting as a part of the business. And then that will grow. But yes, there are certain individuals that feel way too comfortable in their golden cage where they can play the policeman. Without having without being responsible for their actions, and yeah, the only thing how you can fix that is to point them to their responsibilities and train them. Not train them in security, but train them in software development. Train them in being part of the business again, because that's where the problem is. Then, if that is your concern,
yes, and they have to act timely, not in the end, so that it costs a lot of time and effort.
Yeah, but then you run into the scaling problem. Eh? So quite often, if you look at the verhouding ratio between security people and developers in an organization, it's somewhere around 1 to 100, 1 to 200. If you're lucky, 1 to 50. I haven't encountered any organization where you have a better ratio. So security people often have a lot of stuff on their hands, on their plates, and they simply don't have the time to continuously interact with all the teams from the start. And that's where security automation can start helping you, right? Because if you can automate all the simple tasks or make them at least less time consuming, you buy time. So you gain more time to start interacting with those teams. And then there's also less need to wait until the last moment, and you have more time to really start interacting with these teams from the start. And threat modeling is, as I explained, a very good way, because it's lightweight. You can do a couple of these sessions in blocks of 1, maybe 2 hours. And the purpose is not to get a full-blown detailed threat model. The point is more to train developers to think about what can possibly go wrong. And that's little knowledge infusions. And quite often you just need 3 or 4 sessions with a team, and they can start doing that on their own and just validate their results with you. And that takes a lot less time. So slowly, you, with all these tiny improvements left and right, you make your life easier, and that buys you time to interact with the teams. Yes? But you have to start somewhere.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you. And I think it's just like creating user stories. If you do it for the first time, it's very difficult. But if you're used to it, it gets easier the longer you work with it.
Yeah, but that's with everything. I mean, your first audit was probably also a lot harder than your latest audit.
Mm-hmm.
So we also got a request from Frank. Next time a presentation about CI/CD pipeline or deep dives for security auditors. Sure, I'm willing to do that. And I agree with you. I already talked mostly about security automation this evening, I think, or a large part. Normally, that's a whole afternoon in the training I give, and even that is not sufficient. So yeah, there's a lot to talk about. And if Isaka has room in the schedule, I'm happy to come back for that.
We're always happy to have you back.
Okay.
But having said that, on behalf of Isaka and Noria, I would like to thank Dave for tonight's presentation. We will set up another meeting with you to set up this fantastic invitation. And for the rest of our participants, thank you very much, and see you all next week at the same time. Have a good evening, everybody. and have a great weekend ahead of you. Bye-bye.